Today, I'm going to show you all of the ins and outs of our new CL-1 lathe. We're going to show you how this lathe works right now, and then show you how to actually set one up. If you have one of these chucker lathes, or if you just want to know how one works before you buy one, fantastic. This video is for you. This lathe has an 8-station automatic turret with gang-style tooling, an integrated coolant tank, and an optional automatic parts catcher. But the most unique feature on this lathe, what might be different than any Haas lathe you may have run in the past, is its optional pneumatic bar pusher. Now, this is a push-to-stop system. Let me show you what I mean by push-to-stop, and then we'll actually set up a job and fill in the details. I load up a bar, I fill in some information on the controls G105 bar feeder page, and then I add a G105 code to my program. My part is run, and each time a G105 is reached in my program, my bar stock is going to advance through my spindle and come to rest precisely against the stop that's mounted on our turret. This whole process repeats itself automatically until the control lets me know that we've run out of bar stock, and it's time for me to load up a new bar and start the whole process over again. Now that I've shown you the basics of how we feed bars, let's look at the specifics. This bar pusher system functions as a giant pneumatic cylinder. I can see if the system is pressurized by looking at our air pressure gauge here. We can adjust the pressure of our push depending on our stock size and type with our regulator, which is here. 35 PSI is the maximum pressure we want to use with this system. To manually push out our bar or the push rod, we're going to use this manual feed switch. If you ever need to relieve the pressure on the system to remove a bar, we can press reset on the control. The pressure will bleed off in just a couple of seconds. If I move our bar push tube from the run to the load position and push on our manual feed switch to the right, we're going to force our push rod out the end of our tube. Now, at the end of this tube is a 60-degree conical live center. Now, this piece is critical to our bar push system. When we're running a job, the front of our stock is going to be supported by our 5C collet, but the back of our stock, this tail end of our material, is going to be centered and held in place by this conical live center. This push rod will be under constant pressure while the machine is running, holding that material in place. If you're running bar stock that's larger diameter than the end of our push rod here, then you'll definitely want to put a 60-degree included chamfer on the end of that stock, which is going to help it center up. If you're running bar stock like I am that's smaller than our push rod, you don't really have to put a chamfer on there, but it's a good idea. Air pressure pushes this push rod out of the tube. To get it back into the tube, we'll either just push it back in by hand or use a push rod. We can run bar stock up to 1 inch diameter and 40 inches or 1 meter long. Once we've loaded up that bar, it's time for us to add our support collars. These are split bushings that support our bar stock at the end of our push tube. A set of these support collars in assorted sizes will ship with the bar pusher. If you don't find the split bushing that you need, just take an existing bushing and bore it out. We want a comfortable slip fit for our stock, about 10 thousandths of an inch oversized. After loading the support collars, we just push the stock flush with those collars and return the bar push tube to the run position. At this point, I'm going to load up the proper 5C collet for our stock and then come back over here to our manual feed switch and feed the bar in most of the way by pushing our switch to the right. I'll feed it by hand for those last few inches as the stock enters that 5C collet. With our stock resting nicely against our 5C collet up in front, we're going to come back here and adjust our chuck clamp. On this 5C system, we'll go ahead and rotate the knurled knob at the back of our drawbar assembly while occasionally pressing the chuck clamp button, which can be accessed with the cover both open and closed. I'll adjust the collet clockwise with the knurled knob until it doesn't clamp, and then loosen it counterclockwise one or two clicks at a time until it clamps with a crisp clamping sound. With our 5C collet perfectly adjusted to hold our stock, we can go ahead and set up our stop that is mounted in our turret. This stop is going to hold our stock in place as the bar is being pushed. Now, for the purposes of this video and for clarity, I've actually made my own stop that says stop. Next, I'm going to make sure that our system has 0 PSI. Then I'm going to close the door and call up tool two into a position. My stop is loaded up into turret position two. So from the control, I'll enter T2 and press turret forward. With the chuck clamp open, I'll then jog our stop up against our material and position it near our spindle. This is the position I expect our stock to be at when my part has been run, when our cutoff tool has cut off that part. Well, we can now move over to our G105 bar feed page on the control. On a classic control, you can get here by pressing MDI and then program and arrowing over to the G105 bar pusher page. Our G105 bar feed page is broken down into four columns. We'll just fill them in one at a time. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now we've already set up the machine mechanically for the bar pusher. Now we just gotta let the control know when and where to push. With our stop jogged up against our material at the cutoff position and column one highlighted, we're just gonna read and follow the on-screen instructions. It says index to tool used as bar stop and jog to part cutoff position. Press F1 to record tool X and Z position. Pressing F1 on the stop cutoff column sets our stop position on the turret and records our stop's machine position, my XZ, for that stop. On to column two. Here, it is asking for our part length plus our cutoff width plus any amount of stock that we'd like to face. Our part is 0.75 inches. Our cutoff width is 2 millimeters, about 80 thousandths of an inch. And I'd like to face off 20 thousandths of an inch off the front of each part. So if we add all those together, my part length is gonna be 850 thou, that's 0.85 inches. This is how far the machine is gonna push out our bar with each cycle. That's what we're gonna enter right here. 0.85, enter. And again, we always wanna fill out these columns going left to right, 1, 2, 3, 4. The control moves us down to the next input field. The on-screen instructions say close the door and press cycle start. The door is closed, I'll press cycle start. Wow, that was pretty cool. What we just saw there is exactly what the machine is going to be doing when we run it in automatic mode. Our bar is going to be advanced and pushed up against the stop that's mounted in our turret. Push to stop. And then it's going to be advanced by that 0.85 inches, the 0.85 that we just entered. On to column three, G105 TC. That's G105 tool change. When a G105 is reached in our program, the control is gonna do a tool change to our stop automatically. But to do this safely, it needs to know where it can do a safe tool change. I'm now gonna jog my turret out of the way, and I can do this right from the G105 bar feed page. Then I'm gonna do a tool change to my longest tool, which happens to be tool five. So I enter T5, turret forward. Okay, so now we're in a great spot to do tool changes, and we can command a few tool changes and make sure everything clears, because this is the position that the turret is going to do a tool change to our stop each time it finds a G105 in our program. With my G105 tool change column highlighted, I'm going to follow the on-screen instructions and press F1 to record this G105 safe tool change location. Remember, this is our G105 tool change location. The control is not gonna go here each time you do a tool change on this lathe. If you want a safe tool change position when you do a tool change, you have to put that in the program yourself. On to column four, our final column. Now this first input field here says push delay. And we're gonna set that to 1.5 seconds. That's a good amount of time. That's the time the control is gonna wait, allowing for the bar to be pushed up against that stop. Our final question here says air, and we're gonna set this to yes. This means that the air is gonna be on to the bar pusher while parts are being run, and that's gonna force our push rod up against the tail end of our stock, allowing our 60 degree conical center to both support and center our stock. So we've filled in all four columns, 1, 2, 3, 4, and now it's time to fill in column five. Well, there is no column five. If there was a 0.5 here, it would be to touch off our tools. It's at this point, after we've loaded our bars and filled in our four columns, that we need to touch off our tools, just like you would on any Haas lathe. But there are a couple unique things about the CL that we want to consider. On my particular setup, I actually have two different tools using the same tool 5 turret location. This is called gang style tooling. The tools are all ganged up. This is pretty easy to set up once you know how. So for my first drill from within a program, I'm gonna call up T505. It's gonna use turret position 5 and offset 5. Now this is pretty typical for a lathe. But for my second drill, that spot drill, I'm gonna be using T515 from within my program. This is unique to gang style tooling. We're gonna be calling up turret position 5, but using offset 15. So again, when I press Z face measure or X diameter measure to set the offset for this drill, I'm gonna be using offset 5. And when I set the offset for that spot drill, I'm gonna be using offset 15. T505, T515. I found the X-axis center line for my drills, my drill holders, using a coaxial indicator mounted in a 5C collet in our spindle. Well, we're on to our final step. I'm gonna call this column 6 or step 6. After we've touched off our tools, we need to edit our program and add our G105. So here's my sample program. And in this, we've got my T101. This is my facing tool. It comes in and it runs. I've got my drill, tool 5, using offset 5. Then I've got my spot drill, still using turret position 5, but it's using a totally different offset. Offset 15 in this case. This is that gang tooling. We finish the part, we do some more things, and then we cut it off using tool 7 and finish up with an M30. Once an M30 is reached, our program ends. Now, this particular CL is equipped with an optional parts catcher, and this is commanded using an M36 and an M37. M36 is the parts catcher out, M37 commands the parts catcher in. So we're gonna bookend our cutoff tool with those codes. I'm gonna add an M36 parts catcher out just prior to my cutoff, and then I'm gonna add an M37 parts catcher in just after the cutoff. And now we get to add in our G105. Now, there are different ways to do this. I like to add my G105 right after my cutoff and before my M30 here at the bottom of my program. Here's our G105. This is where it's gonna do our bar push. Now, if we ran this program, we'd only run one part, right? It would hit that M30 and stop. So we're gonna change this M30 to an M99. Now we're gonna run my part. After it's cut off, it's gonna push out that bar into the right position to run another part. Then it's gonna hit that M99, go back to the beginning of the program, and do the entire thing over again. It's just gonna keep repeating this process, making you money, until this switch is reached, letting the machine know that we've reached the end of the bar. At that point, something will come up on your screen saying that we've reached the end of our bar and it's time to load up another one. And if we want to keep running parts and load a new bar, it's easy. We'll pull out our end of bar remnant, push our push rod back into the bar tube, and load up a new bar, like we did at the beginning of this video. If I'm loading a new bar, I'll push the bar flush with the face of the collet. Then I'm going to close the collet, close my door, and then I'm going to start my program from the G105. G105, down arrow, cycle start. The control does the rest. Well, we've shown you how to set up and run your CL with a bar pusher. Now, see this stop that I've used? I made this custom just for this video, but you don't really need it. Using the side of your cutoff tool or any tool works just as well. We've got a whole bunch more information in the CL addendum, the chucker lathe addendum. So check out the Haas website, go to the manual section, and look for the CL manual. That's it, and thanks for watching.